Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College in the Dalles, Oregon. This is Digital Electronics 1. This is our introductory lecture in Digital Electronics 1. What I'd like to do is just kind of give you guys a background about myself, a background about the course, and how it's organized in our online hybrid offerings. Additionally, give you some guidance for those individuals that are enrolled in the course and those individuals that are outside the course but interested in digital electronics. First off, I'm an electrical engineer. That's my background. I'm a graduate of Clarkson University in Potsdam, New York. I was in the National Guard while I was in Clarkson. Immediately following my graduation, I joined the Army. I was a regular Army. I was ended up getting out as a captain in the 4th Infantry Division. Got to do some really cool, exciting things, and then got involved in the semiconductor industry, which in comparison to the Army was extremely boring. Not to say that there wasn't some really cool technical challenges. I got to see some really neat places on Earth, but I was inside all the time. So I ended up getting out of that and getting into renewable energy power generation, which is definitely one of my things I'm very interested in. I definitely see the parallels between homeland security and renewable energy, and I'm definitely striving to make our country energy independent. That's definitely one of my goals. So I was started working at Columbia Gorge Community College a couple years ago on a grant-funded, basically it was a two-year position that I ended up working at CGCC to develop some of the courses in an online hybrid format. Following expiration of the grant, I was actually offered a full-time position, and I've actually been teaching at Columbia Gorge Community College since, I believe it was fall 2008. So, absolutely love working here. It's a great opportunity for me. I've learned a lot. And one of the things I've done, which has become wildly popular beyond my even expectations here, are these online lectures that I've done. So like I say, I started doing some of these things for the basic electronics series and now the digital electronics series. I started in fall 2009, and here it is. It's fall 2013, and I'm redoing some of these lectures because there's a fundamental change in the way digital electronics is applied in industry. Not to say the stuff that we have been teaching was invalid, but what I'm saying is that there is a better way to teach it, and we're going to go ahead and redo some of the digital electronics series. So if you're looking for some of the older lectures, chances are they've been removed. Okay, it's some of the same content, but what we are doing is updating it to a more modern format. Okay, so like I said, some of my earlier videos have become wildly popular. 52,000 hits on some of these things. You know, I've become more popular than Shakira. So that's just a joke. I'm not more popular than her. Anyways, how the old courses were organized were kind of like this. Digital Electronics 1. Whoops, that's the wrong pen. See, and I'm getting used to this thing again. Okay. So Digital Electronics 1 was combinational logic. Digital Electronics 2 was sequential logic. Digital Electronics 3 was programmable logic, digital signal processing, and computer topics. So that is the previously way that we've organized this. This new approach, what we're trying to do, is teach combinational logic with programmable logic, sequential logic with programmable logic, and DSP and computer topics with programmable logic. Basically, this is the way the new digital electronics are applied. And I'm not saying TTL, which you learn about later on, is invalid. It's an excellent way to learn digital electronics. And we are going to do a bunch of labs with TTL because it illustrates the essential properties we want to know about digital electronic circuits. But the programmable logic has become kind of the industry standards. And we'll learn more about the difference between TTL, CMOS, ASIC, application-specific integrated circuits, and a programmable logic, okay? Because back when I went to school, back when Def Leppard's drummer still had two arms, basically programmable logic It kind of maxed out at the CPLD, Complex Programmable Logic Device, and since then it's advanced beyond to the Field Programmable Gate Array, FPGA. So a couple years ago, my coworker and myself, Tom Lawrence, and I ended up attending a National Science Foundation Allied Trade Education Basic and Advanced FPGA workshop hosted by Craig Keefe of Cosmiac. So what his goal was is to teach community college instructors how to apply the FPGA, which is the latest technology. It's basically an advancement beyond the CPLD, because what they were recognizing in industry is they needed technicians that were capable of writing VHDL code using the FPGA. So Craig has a number of resources available for students, and I'm going to make use of them in our course at his website, cosmiac.org/fpga.html. Okay, so go ahead and visit that. We are going to be making reference to that and basically even applying some of his labs and tutorials to our course. Okay, one of the things too I wanted to do is give a guidance for some of the students enrolled in CGCC's Digital One course. First off, the lectures. These online lectures which I've posted are for you. The deal is don't show up to a gunfight with a knife because you're going to look stupid. Show up with these lectures in your head, okay? Basically, show up prepared. Do the assigned reading. Watch these assigned lectures and take notes. Be actively involved with these lectures. Pause these things. If I give an example, go ahead and pause. See if you can try to work up with the same example, same answer that I get, okay? So actively take part in these lectures. You're going to be assigned some take-home projects. Show up with those things done. When you walk into a lab, the first thing you're going to be handed is a quiz. It's a basic quiz testing your assimilation of those lectures and those projects that you've done, okay? So if you don't do well on that quiz, you're not allowed to take the lab because you're going to waste your time, your lab partner's time, and my time. So again, show up prepared. And if you've got to show up with a knife at a gunfight, show up with a sharp knife, okay? There are basic electrical concepts you need to know, have already assimilated prior to coming into this. You need to know KVL. You need to know Ohm's law. You need to know all those basic electronics theorems that we've gone over in basic electronics 1 and 2 and 3, okay? So what I'm saying is you can't walk into this course without an understanding of electronics theory. It's not intense, though. The mathematics involved with digital electronics is very minimal, okay? It's not like there's some crazy esoteric math that I'm going to teach you, or any of the electrical concepts are really that advanced. But what I'm saying is you're going to be using some of those basic electronics concepts from 1, 2, and 3 on a daily basis. What you need to do is you need to show up into this digital electronics lab swinging your multimeter like a pair of nunchucks, because you know what's going on already with basic electronics. I'm not teaching you basic electronics. This is digital electronics, okay? Regarding the lectures, I have a tendency to do them relatively free form, as you can tell by probably some of my grammatical or spelling errors that we've probably already exhibited in this single short introductory lecture, okay? That being said, there are errors that need to be corrected, okay? If I've made an error and I discover it later on in these YouTube lectures, what I would do, and I'm going to post them on our Moodle website as to where the errors are, exactly what the time is. But if you're watching this thing straight on YouTube, just go ahead and click to the user comments. If you discover an error, you're like, hey, I think Jim did something wrong, click on the user comments, because what I'm going to try to do is if I recognize an error, if someone tells me that there's an error in such and such lecture, I will go ahead and post in the YouTube comments what the error is, where it is, okay? So those things will be ongoing. Additionally, regarding these lectures, I'm trying to keep them concise to a single topic. There are a couple times when I'm going to have a 45-minute lecture where I just run on and on and on and on. But what I'm going to try to do is keep them to single topics. If you have problems with that single topic, hit it again and again and again and again. basically you want to get these single concepts behind you, okay, before you advance on to the next lecture. And that's what's great about these YouTube lectures. You're capable of watching them again and again and again. And you, over the course of a number of times of repeated exposure, you should be able to get that concept in before you move on to the next concept. Additionally, these things are awesome for review. What you do is go ahead and knock out your week's assigned lectures, next week's assigned lectures, on and on and on. And as you approach the midterm, what you want to do is go ahead and start reviewing week one, week two, week three, so on and so forth. And same thing with the final. Go ahead and review the whole course. And what's awesome about this thing is you go ahead and get a job and you got a problem with some digital electronics theory, you can remember that you can always come back to these lectures. They will always be available for you. And over the course of time, I think we're going to have more at CGCC. So definitely take advantage of this delivery format. Okay. One thing about the hybrid, the online lectures. Yeah. You have to show up to lab. Like Woody Allen says, 80% of life is just showing up. You got to show up for lab every single week. You cannot do a digital electronics course without an applied lab. Okay, so the lectures are going to give you the knowledge. The labs are going to let you apply hooking up a circuit, programming VHDL. And sometimes there's our workshops. There are just workshops where we get together and do K-maps together, and I need to look you in the eyes and see that you've got this thing, and I need to be available to make sure that you are understanding these things, or if you've got a question, I'm right there, okay? So show up for these labs and workshops and exams, okay? Very similar to my electronics 1, 2, and 3 classes, you are authorized one sheet of notes, 8.5 inches by 11 inches, handwritten. Actually, whatever you want to put anything on there. You can photocopy it, micro shrink it, I don't care. 8.5 by 11. You can write it on the front side, the back side, the inside, the outside, and the edges. Basically, cram as much information as you possibly can on that sheet, because check this out, you get to keep that sheet every single week. Put something on it. The next week, put something more on it. Week 3, week 4, week 5, pretty much you have an assembled cheat sheet the whole time. And the other thing is about this, you can go ahead and keep that cheat sheet when you show up for your first job. If you've ever got a question, you go ahead and refer to those things. In the Army, we use this thing called smart books. I don't remember all the call for fire radio telephone procedures, but when I go ahead and pull out my smart book, I've got the entire procedures written out for me, so that way I can remember more important things, okay? So use those cheat sheets. It's a way of forcing you to study and write down the important concepts, okay? It's a guideline. Okay, so again, use those cheat sheets as a guideline, not as a crutch. You can't put everything on that sheet. Put down some basic principles and you'll do fine. Okay, last but not least, since these things have become so crazily popular, I wanted to put some guidance for students not enrolled in CGCC. We're part of an RET program, Renewable Energy Technology Program. We are probably going to branch out into manufacturing engineering technology programs into the future. What they are, they really are based in the electronics engineering technology program. We had a huge development within our region around about 2006 with renewable energy. And what we saw was a fit between the electronic engineering technology program and some of the alternative energy power generation being installed in our region. All we needed was mechanics, hydraulics, and motor control. We added those courses to it, and it became the Renewable Energy Technology Program. It's still digital electronics. It's still electronics engineering, but we just added a couple jack-of-all-trades things to it. So that's what our program is. Our website is listed right here. We're in the Dalles, Oregon, between Oregon and Washington, kind of north central Oregon, south central Washington. We got a campus in Hood River. We've got a nursing program. It's a neat facility. If you're in the area, please come by and visit. And if you want to enroll in the program, feel free to go ahead and contact us and take a visit, take a tour. One of the other things too is if you're not enrolled in CGCC, if you have no interest in attending CGCC, by all means, use these lectures. I know there's a ton of folks out there enrolled in digital electronics in whatever school, wherever on earth. Go ahead and use some of these things. There are other resources available. Like I said, Craig Keefe at Cosmiac has got a bunch of stuff on FPGAs and microcontrollers. Bill Kleitz has an entire lecture series of digital electronics supporting his practical approach to digital electronics with VHDL, 9th edition textbook. He's got a bunch of those things. I'm gonna link to some of those lectures too. Use as many resources as you possibly can, because sometimes you may have an instructor that explains things in one way, and I might explain it the exact same stuff in a different way, but you might get my explanation better. Or I might be messing this thing up and doing a horrible job of explaining it, and somebody else's description might do a better job. What I'm saying is get your information from a number of sources and a number of different methods, and you'll probably be able to get it, get the concept that everybody's trying to discuss. Okay. One of the frequently asked questions that I'm constantly being barraged by my email is, what program am I using to record this? It's Camtasia. All I'm doing is using Microsoft OneNote. Okay, so that is the number one question that I'm being asked. Number two, thank you very much for the comments and thank yous. If you've got suggestions for these things, or if you just want to send me a thank you, feel free to go ahead and write those comments on the side of a $50 bill and send it to me at the Dallas, Oregon. But the problem is, I am an instructor at Columbia Gorge Community College. And my priority is those students at Columbia Gorge Community College. And I've been getting a lot of emails lately that you need some help designing things or working on your master's thesis. I don't have that time, guys, because check this out. I do radical things every single day, and I don't have time to work on your master's thesis. I don't have time to design a circuit. I don't have time to help out in your homework program. Homework problems, because I kiteboard, I kayak, I mountain bike, I've got a son, I've got a wife. In short, I do a lot of cool things, and I don't have time for your homework, okay? So this is being a little silly here, but my priority is the students at Columbia Gorge Community College. Feel free to make use of these lectures as you see fit, but I'm sorry, dudes, I cannot help you out with your master's thesis, as awesome as it might be. I'm not going to be your Facebook friend either, so don't send me requests. By all means, use these videos to your advantage. Okay, I think we've got enough for the introductory and background and general scheme of things. So go ahead and enjoy as we enter the Digital Electronics 1 course.